This is the fourth video lecture on the chapter Older Adults, and I want to pick up where we left off last time, talking about memory and some of the memory changes that happen in older adulthood. And now I want to pick up talking about personality development. Keeping in mind one of the things we've talked about from the beginning is how, from the life course perspective, development is never over unless you are dead. So our personality continues to develop into later adulthood. Now, this is a picture of Erik Erikson that we've talked about before. He's the fella that has the theory about the different stages or the different crises in life. So we have all these things that we have to, these crises, right? And the one that is in this stage of life is what's called ego integrity versus despair. And the virtue is wisdom. And he defines, or our textbook discusses, wisdom as basically accepting your life and all of its imperfections with minimal regrets, or without any major life regrets. So I really like that phrase, accepting the imperfections of your life. And of course, the significance here is it's going to be a whole lot easier to die if you can die with peace. Also, in this discussion on personality, is we have the reference to the big five personality traits, which hopefully by now you've done the big five personality assessment. It included the one that was Ocean, O-C-E-A-N, and various things like this. So what the research tells us happens later in life, maybe you remember where you scored, it tells us that the C, conscientiousness, that older people seem to score higher. They have their conscientiousness increases, their decline for openness to new experience decreases, which I think about my own life, right? I'm not in this stage of life, but I can begin to see some of that stuff. And also significantly, your neuroticism. And neuroticism is, so conscientiousness is sort of is rule following, openness to new experiences, you like new things. Neuroticism is your sort of moodiness. And just like I've said in a previous slide, we see the same kind of pattern, that decline in negative emotions, right? That older people show a decline in negative and positive emotions. In this part of the textbook, it suggests that they stay the same, but at the very least, we know they stay the same, maybe they even increase. But the key here significantly is that self-reporting negative emotions decrease. One theory as to why this is happening is something called a socio-emotional selective theory. And this would be a great thing to show up on a quiz, the socio-emotional selective theory. And that theory says, is that kind of what I see in my mother, at least, is that as we age, we become more particular, we become more selective, more socially selective about who and what we engage in for the emotional response. So your book uses the language that older people seek out emotionally gratifying activities. We quit doing the things that are not satisfying. You know, by this point, maybe you're able to retire. Maybe at this point, you figured out what kind of friends you need. You've gotten rid of the things in your life that don't give you any gratification or are the baggage, and we show. So we begin to report fewer negative emotions because we are being more selective about the things we are doing and the people we are with. And it goes on to talk about how the outgoing people continue to be outgoing. Outgoing. And there's also, according to your book, it says that neurotic personalities, people who score high on neuroticism, have a lower survival rate. So they may not be living this long, which, you know, all does sort of make sense if you think about it. I love this picture. Apparently this one's some picture of the year. Some of the things that promote well-being later in life. So we've already talked about in a previous chapter, we talked about coping. And I believe in that chapter, you had an assessment that asked you what your coping style was, right? Where you had the problem-focused coping and the emotional-focused coping. That's it's finally discussed here in your textbook. There's also reference to something called an ambiguous loss. And the reason, it's interesting to me, because in a previous textbook we talked that I used, ambiguous loss was made in reference to when a woman loses a pregnancy during miscarriage. But in this case, it's referenced to at the end of life, maybe for a caregiver who's caring for somebody with Alzheimer's, right? Who's somebody with severe dementia, because that would be like an ambiguous loss. They're both there, but they're also not there. It's like my mom talks about her partner who's suffering, his dementia is getting worse. And, you know, she'll routinely say, I just remember the good times we used to have. It's like he's not there anymore. And so sometimes it's called anticipatory grief, where we begin to grieve something that we haven't yet lost, right? But this is very useful. Emotional focused coping is very useful for preparing for something that it's not exactly gone. We can't do anything about it, right? There's also a discussion here about what's called adaptive defenses. And these are, so the research that looks at why or how some older people cope better than others has identified one, two, I should actually number these instead of having them with pearls next to them. Maybe I can do that right here. List five, right? Altruism is giving, humor is giving without any expectation of return, humor, why the women are laughing. Suppression is sort of ignoring emotions, anticipation, looking forward to better days, sort of that's kind of like hopefulness. And then sublimination is when it's sort of a fancy word for distraction. So when we focus our attention on something else as a form of distraction. So those are just some coping strategies that older people have been recognized. This is an interesting discussion too. What accounts for what's called successful aging? And so these are different theories about the people that have been identified or a path of aging that's been called successful. There are considered to be three components. So three things that are critical to aging, maybe another word would be gracefully. I don't know another way to think about it. That's why it's in quotation marks there. Of course, the first one is avoidance of disease. The longer you can stay healthier, the longer you can stay healthy, the more you can engage in the world, the easier it is to get around. The second is maintain a high physical and cognitive function. So the more clearly you can think, the more you can be independent, the more you're physically able to function, the more you can move about independently without the assistance. And then the third one is being engaged in productive and social activity. So basically it's stay healthy, stay mobile and clear of thoughts, and stay connected to other people, right? Those are considered the three components. Once upon a time, the theory is that successful aging was this, what we call the disengagement theory. And it was thought that it was normal and it was a natural part of healthy aging to begin to withdraw from other people. And that was sort of like the way the sick animals do when they go off, you know, to hide in the woods to die alone. But that has since been replaced by what's referred to as an activity theory of aging. And originally, the activity theory of aging said that that the better aging, the more active you were, the better you aged. But that has been refined and replaced with something called the continuity theory of aging. And that basically says that people who successfully age, and I think what we mean by successfully age, that they age, that as they move towards the end of their life, they're doing so with a sense of well-being. And this continuity theory says it's the people who continue to carry on the same kinds of tasks that they were doing before. And it's not the same thing as not retiring, but it's if you were, say, an academic, that you continue to be engaged in intellectual work. If you were a craftsperson, that you continue to engage in crafty kind of work and you stay connected to whatever communities you were a part of. You can retire from the paid labor force, but whatever kinds of activities and social groups you were a part of, you stay attached to those just at a different level. And that's what then is referred to as the process of selective optimization and compensation. So the idea, these are fancy terms for that we get more particular, we select, right? We're pickier about the activities that we do, recognizing that I can't do as many of them as I used to do, and I may not be as fast at doing them as I used to do. I may not be as effective. So I'm going to optimize my resources by being more selective in what I do. And I continue to be engaged. I just can't do as much as I once upon a time did. I'll stay on the board of directors, but I'm not going to be a chair, and I'm not going to volunteer for that committee anymore. That's my own stuff. Okay, I'm going to stop here, and then we wrap up. I've got just a couple other topics left.